Alrighty, everybody. We have one more talk to go before coffee break, and that will be Terry Zink from Microsoft. Terry?
Thank you very much, Mikko. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for coming to watch my presentation. My name is Terry Zink. I'm a program manager at Microsoft, and this is my discussion on how to use DMARC to improve your email reputation. So just first of all, a bit about myself. I've been fighting spam for 10 years, so I've seen quite a few techniques in my time. And also, just a bit of a note here, I'm actually a bit sick. I'm getting over a cold, so if you hear me coughing or sneezing a bit, please bear with me. If you heard me coughing or sneezing during other presentations yesterday, sorry. All right, so let's just go do a bit about what we're going to go through today. We're going to talk about how DMARC works. DMARC stands for Domain-Based Message Authentication, Reporting and Compliance, or Conformance. It's a very long acronym. I don't find it useful. That's what we usually refer to it as, just plain old DMARC. So anyhow, we're going to talk about what DMARC does, some of its upsides, some of its expected downsides. We'll go into a case study about DMARC, and finally, we'll wrap things up with my conclusion. But to begin with, I would like to go through a bit of a demonstration. And for this one, Mikko, you didn't know I was going to do this, but I'm going to actually ask you to help me out. So what I have here is a deck of cards, all right? You can actually sit there, it's fine, doesn't matter. It's an ordinary deck of cards, yes. So Mikko, you may go ahead and just give them a quick shuffle. That'll be great. Yeah, that's good. We're actually on a time budget here, so that's, thank you very much. Yes. Sorry, I have to find a Kleenex. Sorry about that. Anyways, so Mikko, here's what I want you to do for me. Why don't you go ahead and pick a card, any card at all. All right, go ahead, pick a card. Yep, that one's fine. Yeah, go ahead, take a look at it. Show it around, but don't let me see it. All right, good. So Mikko, I'm not going to attempt to guess your card, all right? I'm going to attempt to guess your card. I'll try to do this by reading you, and you look kind of tough to read. So your card's going to be either a red card or a black card. And judging by the way you flinched just there, I'm going to guess it was a black card, am I right?
You're right.
All right, okay. So of the black cards, is going to be a clubs or a spades. And of the two of them, I'm guessing it's probably going to be a clubs.
Clubs.
Yes. All right. So the cards run either low cards, 2 through 7, or high cards, 8 through an ace. And I'm going to start with the top and kind of go down. I'm going to guess a low card, yeah. And another 2 through the 7 on the low end. Yes, your card, Mikko? Yes or no? The two of clubs.
Two of clubs.
Two of clubs.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
Amazing.
So at this point, you're all probably wondering, how did he do that? How did he do that? Did his card trick use trick cards? I don't know. It looks like an ordinary deck of cards. Are me and Mikko some sort of secret partners? Did we set this thing up ahead of time? I mean, maybe we did, maybe we didn't. Let's see. Did I do some sort of weird sleight of hand where I got to pick a card? Or is it something else? And the answer is I use trick cards. Because while you see this one card is a two of clubs, indeed, every card in this deck is a two of clubs. And when you know every card in the deck, it's pretty easy to guess what the card is. But at this point, you're all thinking, wait a second, didn't you just show the cards at the very beginning? And no, I didn't, because I'm also interested in behavioral psychology and how we make memories. And I didn't actually show you the cards at the beginning. No, what I did was I said, every card is different, show them to myself, and what you think you saw is what I actually made you think I saw every card, but you didn't. They were actually the same card every single time, and that's what I did. And the reason I did it is to prove a point. What I did was not fair. It was completely not fair, and phishing attacks are not fair because they exploit certain patterns in the way we think, and they are not fair. And so we all know what phishing techniques are. You know, I've been working for spam for 10 years, and phishing is where you go into a web page, enter your username credentials, and they steal your stuff. That is yesterday's phishing attack. Today's phishing attacks are much more insidious. So I'm going to tell you a fictional story about a guy by the name of Tom. Now, Tom is this guy, airline pilot, flies over the Nazca lines in Peru. He's got his own private airline. He works for a company called Zinco Airlines. And Zinco Airlines always arrives on time. They have comfortable seats. They have served you good food. They're always friendly. As you can tell, they're completely fictitious. And Tom is a very, very studious guy. Every morning, he gets this email from these alerts saying, he gets his alerts that tells us what's going on? What's the daily weather? So one day, Tom gets this. Every single day, he's very, very, very industrious. He does these sorts of things. So he gets this email. It looks like a real thing, right? So what he does is he goes and he clicks on the link and he goes to the web page like any of us might do any days. He goes and enters in his username, then his password. He clicks sign in, and he's only vaguely aware that Zinco Airlines is in the URL, if he looked at it at all. But he doesn't see it goes to this phpforms.net page. And so that's what phishers do. That's what advanced phishers do. They want to get inside your organization and then move laterally. And that's what today's phishers do. They're very targeted to get inside your organization. And that's why phishers are hard to detect, because users cannot see what's going on. It really is unfair to ask an average user to detect that sort of thing. So why is phishing so hard to detect? I mean, I've been doing this thing for 10 years. Why is it still so difficult? Well, just like what I've got up there, these messages look like the real thing, so users don't necessarily know the difference between what's right and what's wrong. And it's hard for users to notice that anything is off. You know, it looks so similar. But the last thing is probably the most important thing, and that's that traditional anti-spam techniques do not work. So anti-spam, lots of it, not all of it, but a big, big chunk of it makes use of looking at reputation. Is reputation good or is it bad? If it's bad, we reject your mail right away. If it's good, we might accept your mail or give it through a letter path to the inbox, that sort of stuff. So the good versus the bad. And there are some basic mechanisms that we use to detect spoofing, that sort of thing. So one technique has been around since 2004. It's called SPF, stands for Sender Policy Framework, and it checks the path of a message. So when it comes from you to me, SPF checks that last hop right there to see, do the IPs and domains, do they line up? There's another thing called DKIM, which does a digital signature, and we talked about it uses some cryptography that verifies the actual sender of the message. Both SPF and DKIM work under certain contexts. The problem is that what you see in your email client is not necessarily the same thing that was authenticated. So spoofers can use that mismatch to get around them. And what DMARC does is it's actually, I call it revolutionary, because it's very, very good at predicting when something has been phished, been spoofed. And so what DMARC does is it first requires, let's do a bit of a peek behind there. So this message came from alerts.zincoair.com. But alerts.zincoair.com, the sysadmin, is very, very studious, very prudent. And he's published a DMARC policy. And what the DMARC policy says is, if somebody's spoofing the from address, the one that the user sees, reject the message. There's also, you can quarantine the message, which means mark as spam, or do nothing. You might want to do nothing under certain circumstances. And so does this message authenticate? Yes, so authenticate with SPF or DKIM, which don't necessarily have to be the same thing that the user sees. What DMARC goes one step forward is that what the user sees and what's authenticated must be the same thing. And if they are not the same thing, if they don't align, then the receiver can choose to throw away the message. So in this case, since the DMARC record policy for zincoair.com says reject the message, then if a spoofer tries to spoof this DMARC Zinco Airlines, the receiver says, throw it away, toss the spam, don't even let the user see it. Because sometimes a user might still go through their junk mail folder, open it up to look at the message, that sort of thing. What DMARC says is that for a good sender, I publish a DMARC record, no one can send mail as me except for me. And that is a big, big change from how other authentication technologies do it, because DMARC sees what you see is what there is. Now, if that weren't enough, that by itself is a pretty good upside of DMARC, but that's not the whole thing, because anti-phishing is one thing, but you also need a way to get from a non-authenticated state to a good authenticated state, and I'll tell you what I mean. A lot of big companies, and I mean a lot of big companies today, do not authenticate their mail. And the reason they do that is because, you know, they're aware of the phishing threat, but they also send a lot of good email that doesn't authenticate. And if you say, throw away my email if it doesn't authenticate, you know, all your marketing messages in December, or around a flight airline, or around the bank holiday, something like that, they all get marked as spam. And while the security guys in your organization might be okay with that, the marketing guys and sales guys are definitely not. And so what DMARC does is it gives you a way to get from point A to point B. And it does this with the reporting mechanism. And so what DMARC does is this guy builds right into the protocols that I send Mikko a message, and it's got DMARC. He throws it away. DMARC says, oh, send a copy of that message back to me. So you spoof a message, and then that spoof message gets tossed away, but I get a copy back. And I can use that for multiple reasons. One way I can do that is say, oh, somebody's spoofing me, it's a malicious spammer, and I can choose to ignore that, I can do a botnet takedown, whatever, it doesn't matter. But let's suppose that I did something very, very silly, and I have in my own mail server here that sends mail authenticates, and I set one up the next day, but I forget to configure it properly. And it happens, and people do it all the time, I'm sure people here have done it all the time. I've done that once in a while. So I'm sending mail from my own good mail server, and it's going out and failing DMARC and coming back to me and saying, oh, silly me, I'll just go and authenticate my email with my other mail server here. It's all good. So I've now detected a misconfiguration over here. I mean, it wasn't a bad thing that it failed DMARC, but I was able to use the reports to come back to me and say, oh, yes, all right, everything's good now. I can fix it. Another benefit of DMARC is that it also lets you inventory third-party mailers. And so a large company like ZinkoAirlines.com might say, you know, sending bulk email is not my thing. I'm going to partner up to this big guy, your ESP, to do it for me. And I might do that multiple times. If you do that enough times, you lose complete control and complete track of who's all doing that. And so if this airline here or this guy sends a message here, fails DMARC and comes back, I can say, oh, this big provider, please set your mail up this way so it can authenticate properly, and do the same thing this one here, the same thing this one here, the same thing this one here, and eventually I can get them all under control and we can all start authenticating our email properly. And so DMARC gives you a path to figure out who's sending mail as you maliciously and protecting yourself against that, while at the same time allowing you to figure out who's doing it as you by accident and then fixing it. So DMARC doesn't necessarily mean mark it as spam. You can say don't do anything, but still send me a report. So it's like a look before you leap sort of thing. You can look and see what will happen before you take the plunge. And once you've done that, you can inventory and authenticate all your email. It takes a while to get to that point, but eventually you can do it. All right, so DMARC is it's a great technology. Excuse me. It's a great technology, and I often say it's the greatest thing since sliced bread in the email industry, at least for the past 3-4 years. But even sliced bread in itself is not the best thing ever, because if you eat too much sliced bread, like white bread is really bad for you. And if you're going to these nutrition websites, they say white bread is the same as eating sugar, you shouldn't eat it. And so even sliced white bread is not that good. And even other types of bread, you know, you go to a restaurant, you fill up on bread, you leave away for the main course, you get full. I mean, sliced bread's great, but it's not unlimitedly great. It's the same thing with DMARC. DMARC is a great technology, but it does have its downsides. It's got some unexpected downsides, actually. Now, I'm not a chess player, but in chess, for those of you who do know chess, there's a rule. Always protect your queen. Your queen is your most valuable piece, so you always want to protect it. But it's not a hard and fast rule, right? It is okay to sacrifice your queen in some circumstances. If you sacrifice your queen, and your position gets weaker for sure, but if your opponent's position gets even weaker because of it, that is actually an advantageous position to do, or you can save yourself from losing the game because you lose your king. But the point is, protect your queen is very, very important in chess, but it's not a hard and fast rule. Well, similarly in DMARC, authenticating your email is always a good thing, and authenticating your email and failing authentication is almost always a bad thing, but not always. And one of the places where that happens quite often is in discussion groups. So this is a little chain here, and as we all know, if I send you an email, it can hop all over the world. You know, it goes from point A and it goes up to point B. And I'm gonna speed things up here because I'm going low on time. But basically the point is that in SPF has to authenticate from this last hop right here, otherwise it doesn't work. So if that email is originating from there, if it'll fail, it will fail a DMARC check because it fails SPF. DMARC says you must pass the SPF, which is path registration, or DKIM, which is a digital signature. So to get around this problem with path registration, path validation, last hop type thing, we have a technology called DKIM, which is a digital signature. And DKIM with a digital signature can survive any number of hops. It's great that way. unless the message is modified. And for the most part, when you send a message to somebody on the internet, it's not modified, except by accident. I mean, it's not malicious, but it happens. But sometimes it happens on purpose. And the place where this happens frequently the most is in discussion groups. So let's say I'm on a discussion list called I Love Magic, that sort of thing, and I send an email to the discussion list. The discussion list fans it out to everybody else. And so when it goes from me to the mailing list, it'll pass DMARC. But from the mailing list to everybody else, it could fail DMARC. And so it's kind of complex how that happens. But the problem is that mailing lists are one of the most common scenarios today where DMARC can fail. And there's people right now in the DMARC working group who are trying to fix that. Early this year, two large companies, Yahoo and AOL, published reject records in their DMARC policies. And that caused a bit of a problem with the mailing list place because it caused all these rejections and bounces, and it caused some bad problems. And they kind of hacked around it. And so the DMARC working group is trying to fix some issues that kind of have hacky workarounds right now. And so whether or not people actually adopt them with the workarounds in place is still to be seen. We'll see if it actually goes anywhere. Yes, so the DMARC can break in that case. All right, so next up, I want to go and talk about a case study. And the case study I want to discuss is Microsoft. So I work for Microsoft. And Microsoft has, if you don't already know this, I'll tell you right now, we have lots and lots of different business units. There's Microsoft as a company. There's Microsoft Health Vault. There's Microsoft Volume Licensing. There's Visual Studio. And there's Xbox. And there's actually much, much, much more. All of these teams send email something@microsoft.com. And none of them talk to each other. None of them talk to a central database manager. So if you're a team at Microsoft, you can set up your own mail server somewhere and just send mail to the internet. You can contract a third party if you wish and just send mail to the internet. You can go to our internal hosting solution and just send mail to the internet. Now, for marketing purposes, that's great that we have so few barriers to entry. But for security purposes, it's actually quite difficult because what it means is that our email does not always authenticate because we don't know who's all sending email as us, as Microsoft. And so we want to fix that. We want to say, all right, we're going to get everything under control. This is what we're going to do. And so we use DMARC to get our SPF record under control. And the way we did this is that, first of all, we published a DMARC record that said, take no action if it fails DMARC. And we waited for reports to come in. So all the spammers were swooping mail as us getting these reports back to us. We took them, we tossed them away. We then got reports back from different teams who were sending mail as Microsoft. So the first team was sending mail from their own mail server somewhere in one of our buildings. They went out and came back. And we said, I'm like, well, that's probably a legitimate mail server. And so I went and tracked down the team who did it. I said, hello, Mr. Team, Mr. let's say Xbox Live. You're sending mail, but you're failing authentication. So please send mail in this particular way. And so they moved off all their infrastructure. I added them to our records, and they authenticated. And I kept doing that. I found the next team that was sending mail, just failing authentication, came back. I talked to them, and I got them to authenticate. And I fixed that as well. There are other teams that are using third-party bulk mailers. And so I talked to the bulk mailers. I got them to set up their records. I got them all under control. I got them to authenticate all their mail. We did this 25 times. I don't think I got them all. We did it 25 times. And we got all of Microsoft's mail to authenticate, or almost all of Microsoft's mail to authenticate properly with valid SPF records. The next step is to get them to evaluate with DMARC. That's coming. But the point is that without DMARC, there is no way we would have been able to get everybody under control without causing a loss of legitimate marketing email. So I think that's a success story for DMARC. I'm actually quite proud of that. And so just to summarize things here, and we are right on time. Just to summarize, DMARC solves one aspect of phishing. It solves the case where your domain is being spoofed. So Microsoft.com, BankofAmerica.com, WellsFargo.com, et cetera, because if that email address or domain is in your address book, that gets rendered, certain parts get hidden from you. And so DMARC does solve that part of it. It doesn't solve all phishing. It doesn't. But it does solve one part of phishing. People from Twitter have said when they published DMARC records, they saw spoofing of their domains drop like almost overnight. Not to zero, but certainly a lot. It fell off. So DMARC lets domains be more secure, and just like how Microsoft was able to authenticate its email. We didn't lose anything legitimate. But DMARC still has its challenges that are not yet solved. And so just to wrap things up here, if I would apply DMARC to that card trick at the very beginning, I would have to disclose to you that I was actually using a deck of cards that was all the same card, and then that would not have fooled anybody. And that's how DMARC would have worked for that card trick. But just in the interest of full disclosure, if I really was doing DMARC for that card trick, I would also have to disclose to you that I was using a second deck of cards right over here, and that the second deck of cards actually does have every single card at the very beginning. And when I told you that every card was actually not the same identity I showed to you, and that I tricked you into thinking that you did, what happened was that I tricked you into thinking that I tricked you into thinking that I did not show you every card when I actually did. And I did that to show you that fishers are not fair. They do cheat. They are not playing by the same sort of rules as the rest of us. You cannot trust them. But DMARC does solve one aspect of the phishing problem. And so with that, I'd like to thank you all very much for watching my presentation, and we'll wrap things up. If we have any questions.